that I think is important that you all know is that this did not happen happenstance, you know. It was not just a fluke. We got a call from Ms. Griffin, and Ms. Griffin needed some help. And we did what we could to help her. And in helping her, we discovered that it was not just Ms. Griffin who needed help, but there were other daycares who could use the same assistance. And this particular workshop grew out of that one phone call. And so we owe Ms. Griffin a round of applause. You know, one of the things that I think is important about what you all do is the emphasis that you place on the lives of children at a young age. People don't realize how important that is. I have three children, two girls, one boy. Every last one of them went through a daycare center, and every last one of them came out shaped into better people because of the teachers and the workers who were at those centers. So I value you, and I hope you get something out of this workshop. I hope that we are able to continue this, and it's not a one-time thing. And I hope as we grow and we learn more about the things that you need, we can provide you more information. Let me tell you a little bit about the Office of Community Engagement. Topic, keep me on time. But the Office of Community Engagement was an office created in 2010. The office was created for a specific purpose, and that was to look into environmental justice issues. Environmental justice having to do with areas of low-income neighborhoods that were disproportionately impacted by different types of facilities that were located around them. And that office began to look at those issues. But as we looked at those issues, our arms actually began to spread into different areas. And we saw there were many areas that needed assistance that were not just included in what we had labeled as environmental justice. And so in 2014, our new executive director brought up under the Office of Community Engagement the Small Business Environmental Assistance Program, which is the program that's responsible for this workshop. And that Small Business Environmental Assistance Program brought a new arm to the Office of Community Engagement. Now, instead of just looking at communities, we're looking at small businesses, the category that you all fit in. And we're seeing that there are some small businesses that don't get the assistance that they need, that don't get the attention that they need, that don't get the help that they need, that don't get the education they need in order to maneuver their way through all these agencies. Many times if you ask a person, well, what does DEQ do? Half the time people don't know. And what's even sad about it, sometimes the people who work at DEQ don't know. But we need to change that, because the work that we do can influence and not only what you do, but it can help you do your jobs better. So I'm not going to prolong the time. I know we got lunch. But I just wanted to make sure that you all know how much I appreciate you being here and how much I value that one phone call, because it's going to lead into something much bigger. I appreciate it. And y'all have a great day.
First presenter for the day is going to be Ms. Gay Logan. She's the Director of Licensure for the Mississippi State Department of Health. So y'all give Ms. Logan a hand as she comes.
The seven and the one below it, but down, what was it first? That's to go back, then down, just get down to prevention slide. There you go, and point it kind of at the projector.
Okay. Good afternoon. If you go to sleep, I'm going to come over and tap you. I think I know a lot of you guys. A lot of you guys have been in my trainings or I've been to your facilities. I'm Gay Logan. I'm with the Mississippi State Department of Health. We regulate 1,300 plus daycare centers in Mississippi. And today, I'm going to go through real quick. I know you guys, some of you guys just cringe when y'all see us coming. But today I'm going to go through the reasons behind why we regulate. It's not just to come out and say, got you, you're doing something wrong. It's not to come out and say, you're not a good enough center. It's for you guys to meet minimum standards. And I'm going to run through a lot of the reasons and why we regulate. Yeah. State Board of Health was established in 1877, and we became the Mississippi State Department of Health in 1982. The reason that it was established was to promote...
Sorry. We got some new equipment.
He can't hear me?
I guess it clips.
Whatever needs to do.
Just put it here. Yep, just tried it.
Basically, it's to protect...
Is she married to the thing?
I'm married to it. Okay. To protect Mississippians. And therefore, childcare licensure was developed to protect children in daycares where they're away from their parents. It is a law that we regulate. Prior to the law, children were in all types of conditions. They were in just various, there was no guidelines for nutrition, no guidelines for fingerprint, no guidelines for qualifications for teachers and caregivers and what they ate. So based on this law, you now have us come out. One thing that we help, Brittany is one of the licensing officials for the state. Awesome. I heard.
Yeah.
Thank you. We help with disease surveillance in Mississippi. The outbreak at the theme parks and in other states, measles, you don't hear about that in Mississippi because we have the highest number of children entering daycare and public schools. We have no exemption for immunization unless it's a medical reason. And we have one of the strictest laws and strictest codes in Mississippi. So I think that's awesome that we do that. Environmental protection, disease and injury prevention. I'm going to get a little bit deeper, so I'm going to fly through these. Basic standards of care. We do not allow spanking. Any type of inappropriate discipline. We only use certain types in child care, and we monitor that. I mentioned immunization, keeping the kids safe in emergencies, if they have to evacuate, if there's a fire at a facility, we monitor that. The day after Christmas, I was in Summerall trying to help a daycare get back up and operating because their whole roof was blown off the building. So we're out there doing this, trying to help the community. Providing services like this, partnershiping with other entities, and social services. Daycare providers are mandate reporters. If you think or suggest, or if you believe there's abuse with the child, daycares are mandated to report that to DHS. And also, if there's special needs in your facility, these services, the workers and providers should be trained to work with the children. We have different appendixes in our regulations, two that are reportable diseases that have to be reported to the health department. We have communicable disease list that needs to be mentioned. Mandate immunization required before. I mentioned that twice already. We monitor the water that comes into the facility and the waste that goes out of the facility. A lot of people will ask certain type of changing, diaper changing sinks and stuff like that. It has to be into the main service. It just can't be a potable where they dump the sewage into the toilet. Kitchens inspected. Our licensing officials are trained just like the environmental going into a KFC or into a hospital. We're on that same level whenever we go into your daycare that we inspect it from that standpoint. Wastewater, we refer to the experts. He'll speak to y'all in a little while. At one point, we tried to, we were training our staff to look at the wastewater, but we kind of got away from that because it entails so much and the laws are ever changing. And basically, my staff are trained now
if your sewage is backing up in your kitchen, or if it's backing up on your playground, then we're gonna call other agencies or other entities within our agency, which we partner very closely with all the other people in this room also. As far as a certified food manager, we require that if you open a container, and this is one thing, I got a call yesterday, and previously we thought the facility was catering, so they didn't have to have a certified food manager. Well, they started opening containers and doing stuff, still catering a little bit, and they said, well, the licensing official never made me get it before. And it's like, well, what are you doing? What are you serving? So you have to have a certified food manager if you open a container. If you're buying completely prepackaged food, if you're buying like individual cartons of milk and the children are serving themselves, we don't make you have a kitchen inspection and a certified food manager. But otherwise, you have to. Lead test on soils for playgrounds. That is not as in-depth as the building inspection, but you do have to have an initial soil test on the playgrounds to be able to operate a daycare. And then lead testing on the buildings prior to 1978. If the bill is that
78 was when lead was banned. The actual regulation says you have to have certain testing on pre-65 buildings, but every building built before 78 has to have testing on it if you're going to do any kind of renovation, repair, or painting.
Right.
So it's good to have an inventory of where the lead is so that you know when you have to have a license contract to come in and do the work.
And you have to have that prior to opening up. Some facilities were opened up years ago and they slipped through the cracks, but for uniformity, we have made them go back and get that testing, and just for the children's protection. One thing I learned in Morning Crystal's training years ago was if a child, a teenager, say, is exposed to lead, high levels of lead, it could affect the baby that she has in the future, 20 years later. That's the reason for the testing. We have a capacity. There are room capacities where you might have a building big enough for 50 kids, but other things come into play. The size of the rooms, we can't just pile 50 kids into one room because you only have two caregivers or the light's not working in the other room or whatever. Toilets, you have to have a certain number of toilets, hand washing sinks. Kitchen has to be a certain size to serve a certain number of kids. And the playground has to be a certain size. So all those come into measurement whenever we're thinking about health and safety. All of the campuses with the have become, in the past, we would allow staff to smoke on the property out of the sight of the view of the children. Say, back behind a tree, back behind the back of the building, behind the dumpsters. We would allow that. But over the years, whenever I first came here, I tried to get it changed, and it took me forever to get that changed. And the reason for that is staff are going outside smoking. They're getting the smoke on their body, their clothes, their arms. They're coming back in and picking up the baby. Well, studies and research is showing that third-hand smoke is worse on you than second-hand smoke. So, I mean, that's hard to believe, but it absorbs into your skin. So whenever somebody's holding a baby next to them, the baby's mouthing and laying on their clothing. So we do encourage, we can't make you when you're smoking, but infant and toddler teachers, we encourage them to wear smocks. That way, whenever they go out to smoke, then they can smoke and then come back in and take that smock off. Or, you know, put a fresh smock on whenever they come in. And I'm not judging because somebody smokes. My sister smoked, and I told my sister that. I said, I'm not judging you. I just think when you get your grandbaby, you need to use best practice. I mentioned the nutritious meals. And then we have a whole section, actually two sections, an appendix and on nutritious meals. No vending, outside vending machines unless it's nutritional. We follow the USDA food program. And we followed this prior to the public schools. It was supposed to be a grandfathering with the public schools, and they had so many years to come into compliance with taking deep fryers out of the kitchens, removing the vending machines, doing certain things that they had years to comply with. Well, when those came down a few years ago, we immediately started training you guys on it. We worked with Donna Speed, our nutritionist, and she comes out and trains and stuff. So we adopted these years ago, and we have won a national award for this. We are number two in the nation for the best practices for nutritious food served in the daycares in Mississippi. We require outdoor play spaces and time. And then all owners and operators are required to go through playground training, safety. All our trainers, all our licensing officials are certified through a national program for playground safety. And this is University of Iowa. And it's something that we make all our staff go through where they can go out and work with you guys and inspect your playground. We require occupant restraints, proper occupant, word's not coming out, restraints on all vehicles when you're transporting kids. That means whenever I get a call from a police officer because there's 22 kids double buckled on a vehicle and the bus is parked at a gas station while somebody runs in to get a Coke or something, then I'm going to come out and address it. Brittany's going to come out and address it because that does happen. So take all these into consideration. We require CPR and first aid. Somebody on site at all times. So keep in mind, if you're the person qualified CPR and first aid, you don't have a backup, you have to be there all the time, the hours of operation. So if you're transporting school-age kids and you've left the property, you need a backup. So it's best practice to get two or three qualified. You have to be inspected by the local fire authority. If you have, we require that you have a smoke detectors, carbon monoxide detectors, and fire extinguishers. And they need to be serviced annually. And we require monthly fire drills. We go out twice a year. We require a national criminal background check and child abuse registry check. The reason we require this is because it's minimum and they're stricter and it's a guideline, it's a law for child care and nursing homes, and it's specific to child care and nursing homes and providers of health services. And the law, we will not even allow the public schools fingerprint to transfer to your daycare. The reason is our guidelines are stricter. We go through four different checks, and they're stricter than the public school. And we also, whenever we first started doing fingerprint and background checks, we had people that was wanted for theft, murder. People like ex-convicts apply for daycares and working at daycares. So it's really a good thing. One thing that's coming down that's going to affect you guys, this is new, is through legislation, through some of the funding that DHS receives. So fingerprints are only going to be good for 5 years. Right now, they are good if you stay at your facility for a lifetime, correct? If you don't change jobs, if you don't have a break in service, then they're good for a lifetime. That is coming down. My understanding is by 2017, you'll have to get that done. Don't go out and do it today. Your letter's good, but we just want it, because it's going to make an economic impact on the, you know, if you have 40 staff, it's going to affect you. We have minimum requirements for personnel, and we offer mandatory trainings throughout the state on a continuous basis. I already mentioned the immunization, no medical exemption. I mean, no exemption for religion, preference. A lot of people don't want it for preference. We require you have an emergency policy, and you need evacuation 1 mile away and 5 miles away. And it would be good to practice it. I know that would be a headache, but it would be good to practice it. It'd be good to partner with another Head Start or another church or community center, but make sure they know that you're using them as an evacuation site. If you do not have a car or a bus, or if you don't transport kids, it's good to partner with somebody that does, maybe a church that does have a large vehicle. They could help relocate you. Monthly fire and disaster drills are required. And then I'm going to kind of jump over this because, as you can see, we monitor everything you do, from your water to your waste to your immunization to don't put a child in a closet, you know, for time out. You'd be amazed, and you see in the media. So, you know, what you guys do makes a major impact on our kids. And I mean, I really appreciate what you, I don't know, I've been in daycare, I've been a director. I don't know this day and age I'd go back into it with all that y'all have to deal with. It does seem like we regulate y'all to death, but it's because of mishaps, it's because of emergencies, it's because of, you know, the different trauma, different media things that have happened. And that's it. Do y'all have any questions real quick for me?
Prevention and Healthy Homes Program, I got all that out. So please give Ms. Beasy a warm round of applause as she comes, okay?
All right. Good afternoon. How are you all doing?
Fine.
Fine. Okay. We're going to start out this afternoon. I'm going to ask a few questions. I've got 6 goodie bags. And the people who can answer my questions correctly will get these nice goodie bags. All right, so first question.
Wait, mic you up. I didn't want to get mic'd up. It's on the floor.
I know. All right, thank you. Okay. Someone tell me, I want you to name one of the 7 principles of a healthy home or daycare. And do not look at your sheets that you were given earlier. Can somebody give me one of the 7 principles of a healthy home or healthy daycare?
Come on, y'all. Good guess.
Come on. All right, lady in the back.
Environmental policy. Protection policy.
No, ma'am. Think about... I'm sorry?
You need a carbon dioxide.
And what do you have one of those for? What's it for?
To detect carbon dioxide in your home.
Okay. For safety.
First one.
Okay. Can somebody tell me one way to reduce SIDS or sudden infant death syndrome?
Vaccine.
Would you pick somebody?
We're gonna work with women.
Okay. Good job. We're also going to learn about some other things, too, but can somebody give me a symptom of lead poisoning? Nobody knows a symptom of lead poisoning. Okay, right. What kind of metals?
You said, well, paint. A symptom of lead poisoning.
A symptom of lead poisoning.
All right.
Vomiting, nausea. Can somebody name a volatile organic compound or a VOC?
We're gonna try chlorine.
Something else. You're close. Say a different word. Right. Yeah. Okay. Name one item that lead is found in, excluding paint. Okay. The lady back here, right here. And there's one more in there.
Which lady? Is that the last one?
Right there.
All right. All right, last bag. This is gonna be the bonus.
And I gotta come up with a question for this one.
Give him a good one.
Yeah. I'm looking. Okay, somebody tell me what a healthy home or a healthy daycare is. What does a healthy home or healthy daycare mean? It doesn't have to be the correct definition, but as long as you pinpoint some of the words.
All right. Ms. Griffin, you want to try?
Yeah.
Okay.
It's safe, conducive to learning, having an environment that's accident prone, making sure that the children don't get hurt. You want me to keep going?
Yeah.
Knowledgeable caregivers.
Okay.
All right.
Okay. All right. So that should have got everybody thinking about what this presentation's going to be about. Okay? We're going to talk about creating and sustaining a healthy home and a daycare. A lot of this stuff that you learned today, you can use in your home as well as in your daycare facilities. Okay? Okay, first I want to start off telling you a little bit about our goals or what our program does. What we do is that we want to increase the public's awareness of the risk of lead poisonings and environmental hazards that are found in the home. And we also want to reduce the families exposed to lead and environmental hazards found in the home. So what we're going to do during this section is we're going to define what lead is, we're going to talk about healthy homes, and we're going to describe the 7 steps to a healthy home or a healthy daycare. So can anybody tell me what lead is?
You gave away all your bags.
Now come on, we got to have some interaction. Come on.
Element.
Ma'am?
It's an element.
It's a, correct. Okay. Lead is a naturally occurring element that's found in the environment, and in small amount, I mean, it's even found in small amounts in the Earth's crust, and it can be harmful to you and to animals. Okay. Some of our sources of lead. We have lead-based paint, pre-1978 homes or daycares, soil. If you have peeling paint on the outside of your daycare center, you're going to have a lot of lead dust in the soil. The children are outside playing in the dirt, putting their hands in their mouth. They get lead poisoning. Food. You may wonder why could food have lead in it? If you think about some of your Hispanic populations, there's Mexican candy that they bring home from their native country that has lead in it. And they will eat the candy and therefore get lead poisoning. Dust. Dust is the major source of lead. If you have peeling paint, chipping paint, there's a tremendous amount of lead dust. So this could be on your windowsills, could be outside on the front porch. Water. Water can also have lead in it, and it's usually homes that are in the rural communities that have well water. It's actually the brass pump that brings the water up from the surface that has the lead in it. So if you know someone who lives in a rural area that has well water, they should not be drinking the water from the pipes. They should be using bottled water. Toys, several years ago there were some recalls from all the toys made in China that had lead in them. And then other household goods, you have your mini blinds that were bought before 1997. Those have lead in them. When the sun hits those blinds, it causes the lead that's inside the blinds to break down, and it causes lead dust, which can collect on the windowsills. It can collect on the furniture next to the windowsills, as well as the slats of the mini blinds itself. Car keys have lead in it. Whether it's your car key, your house key, your post office box key. How many times have you been in the grocery store, mom has given the keys to the child to entertain the child? That child could be getting exposed to lead. Whether they're putting the actual keys in their mouth, or if they're touching, you know, playing with their keys with their hands and then putting their hands in their mouth. Water hoses have lead. Perfect time of the year, kids are outside playing, they want something to drink outside, they drink from the water hose. They could be getting exposed to lead. Also, people who work with lead, welding, construction, painting, mechanic, all of those can be getting exposed to lead on the job and bringing that home to their family, tracking the lead dust inside to the home. First thing the child does when they see dad, run up, give dad a hug, get lead dust on their hands, put it in their mouth. They can be lead poisoned. Oh, went the wrong way. Okay, signs and symptoms of lead. Just by looking at a child, you'll never know they had lead poisoning. The only way to know is through that lead test, which is a requirement by a lot of the Head Start centers in order to get enrollment into the Head Start centers. But some of the signs and symptoms can mimic other things such as the flu, like stomach ache and cramps, irritability, behavior problems, sleep disorders, and developmental delays. Studies have been done that have shown children exposed to lead as a child, when they become adult, could be linked to criminal behavior. People who are committing criminal behavior as an adult can be linked back to them being exposed to lead as a child. So what is a healthy home or a healthy daycare? We want every family to live in a healthy home. We want every child to visit a healthy daycare. So what is a healthy daycare or healthy home? It is one that is designed, constructed, maintained, and rehabilitated in a way to support good occupant health. So why are we concerned about healthy homes and daycares? Well, because young children spend as much as 70% of their time inside their home and inside the daycares. And homes can affect the health of individuals both physically and mentally. Why should we focus on healthy homes and healthy daycares? We want to reduce the number of homes and daycares that have moderate or severe physical problems which place residents and children at risk of fires, falls, rodents, lead poisoning, mold and mildew, carbon monoxide, and asthma. Some of the possible health conditions that may be caused by hazards in the home or the daycare: asthma, brain damage from lead poisoning, behavior and learning conditions from lead, injuries, cancer, poisonings, and allergies. Poor housing conditions and poor daycare conditions are associated with the risk of poor mental health. Depression could be caused from a lack of light or an association of dampness and mold. So here are 7 healthy homes principles for both a home and a daycare. You want to keep the daycare dry, clean, ventilated, pest-free, safe, contaminant-free, and maintained. If your home and your daycare is maintained by the 7 healthy homes principles, then you will have a healthy home or healthy daycare. Okay, keep it dry. Can somebody tell me what that is on the wall? Okay. Mold. If you see mold or mildew, that means you have a leak. You have something causing, has to be water coming in from the roof, leaking pipe, that's causing that mold and moisture. Mold and moisture and mold can result in compromised health and well-being. If you have mold in your home and you have somebody in the home that has asthma and allergies, that mold and mildew can trigger an asthma attack and bring on their allergies. Dry homes minimize moisture and mold. And if you have water or leaking pipes, it also attracts, the water attracts cockroaches, rodents, and helps dust mites thrive. Because all these things, the cockroaches and the rodents, they have to have a water and food source. Keep it clean. We don't like to see kitchens or areas like that when we do our home visits. But we have seen some, though. Keep it clean. You want to make sure there's minimal dust and clutter. If you have a kitchen or an area that looks like that, you can be guaranteed there's going to be pests, cockroaches, rats, and who knows what else there. You want to keep your rooms and surfaces clean and dry to reduce asthma and allergies. And then you want to keep your counters and cupboards clean and organized to reduce pests and rodents. Keep it ventilated. Okay, does the daycares have to have exhaust fans in the bathrooms? No. Okay, well, this will be for your home. How many of you all have exhaust fans in your bathroom? Do you use them? Okay, and they're not there because the reason they're there, I'll let you figure that one out on your own. The reason they are there is because when you shower or bathe, you have steam from the hot water, and that fan pulls that moisture and mold or moisture out, which if it doesn't pull, if you don't have a vent fan, it can lead to mold and moisture. If you don't have a vent fan, you can always crack the window if you feel safe and you have a window in your bathroom. Dryers and hot water heaters should be vented to the outside. We have seen a lot of when we do our home visits where the dryer vent is actually vented into the garage. Well, if you close your garage and you're running your dryer, you're going to have a lot of moisture, which can lead to mold and mildew. Okay, what is this? Mm-mm. No. What is that? Okay, this can be behind a refrigerator, it can be behind a bed, it can be behind a crib, it could be behind curtains. Okay, this is what's called frazz. Frazz is cockroach feces. If you see this in your daycare center, under the cabinet, in your home, you've got a serious cockroach problem. Now, no, this is their poop. This is their feces. So if you see that, you've got to have a bunch. Now, keep it pest free. Daycare center, Head Start center, home.
See, this crystal, what area? What area is that?
In the house. Is it on outside or inside? What?
That looks like the outside, but it can be on the, I've seen
it's
it on
the baseboard. That's the baseboard.
Yeah.
That's it.
Yeah.
It's the bottom of a wall.
Baseboard, uh-huh. Like around, like this.
And it'll come with the odor as well.
Can we?
Uh-huh. Yeah, we do SPS.
Yeah.
I've seen that
with
refrigerator.
Yes. Yep. So not only might you see mold and mildew, you might see frazz too. So, keep it pest-free. You want to remove the food and water sources because there again, you have to have food and water for the cockroaches and the rodents to survive. You want to seal holes in the walls and ceilings with caulk or steel wool. And you want to use non-toxic pesticides, something such as integrated pest management or IPM. The pesticides that people spray in their homes in the daycare centers, if you use foggers, those are all toxic. They have volatile organic compounds in them. They're toxic to your health, causes you to have headaches. They can make asthma and allergies worse. So what we tell everyone is to use integrated pest management or IPM, which you use jails, traps, or bait stations. Like the glue traps you can see sitting around or the roach motels. Those are the better things to use rather than the Raid and the Combat and all of the other toxic chemicals. Keep it safe. As Gay mentioned earlier about the smoke alarms and the carbon monoxide alarms, it's very important that you have a smoke alarm because it's the only way to know or to alert you to get out of the home if there's a house fire. Carbon monoxide. If you have gas appliances, whether it's a water heater, a gas stove or gas heaters, you need a carbon monoxide detector because carbon monoxide is a colorless, tasteless, odorless gas that's emitted from gas burning appliances. The carbon monoxide detectors will actually go off if it senses too much carbon monoxide. You want to make sure you have cabinet locks and electrical outlet covers at the daycare centers, especially in the small infant and the toddler rooms. And then all your cribs must comply with the new crib safety standards. All the drop side cribs should be done away with now. There should be no more drop side cribs in daycare centers. keep it contaminant-free. As Gabe mentioned earlier about the secondhand smoke, even though they go outside to smoke at the daycare centers with their frocks on, they can still come in and have those carcinogens or those toxins on their clothes. There again, secondhand smoke can lead to the risk of SIDS. It increases the risk of SIDS deaths. You want to avoid volatile organic compounds. Okay. How many of you all in the daycare center uses plug-ins, air fresheners, candles, incense, or in your home? Okay. And your cleaning supplies like Clorox, Mean Green, Fabuloso. All those contain volatile organic compounds. There again, toxic to your health. Yes. Yes. There was a study done, a lady that used to work with me, she went to Jackson State University, they did a study. This individual was constantly having severe migraines. They had plug-ins in their house. The lady removed the plug-ins for a couple of months, her headaches went away. Yeah, for real. So, anything that says that it can smell good for 30 days has some type of chemicals in them that's bad for you. So, instead of using all of those, the candles and the air fresheners and the incense and all of that, what we're telling everybody is to go back and do going green recipes like I gave you, the little booklet you got today, using baking soda and vinegar for your cleaning, for your air fresheners. And then you want to avoid pesticides. Keep it maintained. Make sure you inspect your pipes for leaks. You want to keep your floors clean. You want to replace windows and air filters in the daycares. Repair your walls, roofs, and halls, and organize. Make sure you're organized in storage. So infant safe sleep, what you need to know. We're going to talk about sudden unexpected infant death. We're going to talk about SIDS. We're going to talk about accidental suffocation and strangulation in bed, as well as the undetermineds. Okay, this is a simple classification chart. You've got your SUID, which is the sudden unexplained infant death, on top. Catch up here. SUID is defined as the death of an infant less than 1 year of age that occurs suddenly and unexpectedly. SUID can be divided into your explained and your unexplained. Your explained is the trauma, the drowning, the known diagnosis, and then the ASSB. ASSB could be, say that the infant died because it got trapped between the mattress and the headboard in mom's bed. Your unexplained is your SIDS, which is the sudden infant death syndrome, which is the sudden unexplained death of an infant younger than 1 year of age, and then you have your undetermined. Some SUID or SID risk factors. Of course, the prone side sleeping positions, it's recommended now by AAP that all children or all infants are put on their backs to sleep. Soft bedding. There should be no soft bedding or blankets in the crib with the baby. Overbundling or overheating. I always tell parents that if you're hot, the baby's hot, or if you're cold, the baby's cold. I've been doing home visits, and I go into the home, and the child is in a onesie and a sleeper with a hat on and scarves on with a blanket over him sitting in the car seat. You know that child is burning up. Bed sharing. Bed sharing is not recommended. We recommend room sharing, where you put the bassinet or the little crib up close to the bed in arm's length, you know, in arm's reach. But we do not want them sleeping in the bed with the parent. Prematurity, prenatal exposure to alcohol and cigarettes, and then male gender. Research has shown that males are more likely to sleep in the bed with their parents than females. AAP safe sleep recommendations. The purpose is to reduce the risk of SIDS and sleep-related deaths due to suffocation, asphyxia, and entrapment. Recommendations are based on strong and consistent scientific evidence, and the recommendations should be used consistently until 1 year of age. Okay, here. On the right-hand side, you have the child laying on its back. As you can see, the trachea is on the top, and the esophagus is on the bottom. If the child was to vomit or have reflux, gravity would work against it, and the vomit and the reflux would come out the baby's mouth. With the baby laying on its stomach, you have the trachea on the bottom, the esophagus on the top. If the baby was to have reflux or vomit, then that vomit is going to get into the esophagus and the into the trachea, leading to asphyxiation and choking. And there again, you can see with the baby laying on the blanket, every time that child breathes, he's actually pulling in that blanket that he's laying on as well.
So you're saying if he's on his back, the child has reflux.
Uh-huh.
It's not grandbaby
head. Uh-huh.
It comes out of the nose.
Well, it comes out the nose. Mm-hmm. Well, well.
And I mean, she can be sitting up.
Uh-huh. Come out her nose.
So.
But on the back, but if they're sleeping, if they are sleeping though, and that happens, it will come out their mouth, because if they're on their stomach, it's going to pull back in the trachea, leading to asphyxiation or choking.
Pertaining to the child in the daycare, if it has a medical reason, a physician will
yeah.
sleep on
the yeah.
Yeah. flip themselves over.
Yeah.
But in this case, in a where a baby has a condition,
yeah.
you would need a medical. And a doctor will give it to you in a heartbeat if it's needed.
These were the references for the presentation. We have the CDC, the National Center for Healthy Homes, U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development, EPA, Mississippi SIDS Alliance. And then this is my contact information. If you leave here, you have any questions, need any SIDS or any Healthy Homes educational materials, give our office a call and we'll be glad to provide it. So does anybody have any questions?
That we don't have a mic. I guess they figured the room was small enough that everybody would be able to hear. But next we'll have Ms. Jeanette Simmons. She's from Region 4 in Atlanta Healthy. She's the Healthy Homes Representative from the U.S. Department of Housing and Urban Development. And I want somebody in this room to pick a number between 1 and 50 for our next prize.
13.
Can I get another one?
21. 15, 25.
She already picked 13.
15.
19.
26. 25. I haven't heard it yet.
44.
10.
1.
5.
7. 7.
Number 2.
44.
49. 7.
33.
42. Okay, she said 13 first. The number was 14 before I got to 15, so I'm going to give it to the lady in the back.
I'm not going to make the mistake and give all my prizes out at the beginning so that we can all, you know, stay engaged. You know, talking about lead-based paint can be quite boring, like watching paint dry. So hopefully everyone can participate and you'll learn something that you can take back to your clients. Typically, I'm in front of regulators and other government officials, so it's good to be presenting in front of folks that are on the front line and that can actually help the clientele that we most often deal with and who we want to improve their lives. And so, again, I work with HUD's Office of Lead Acid Control and Healthy Homes, and primarily what we do is we address those indoor environmental issues that impact adults as well as children, but mainly children in particular. And we sort of have, we have these posters here that, you know, runs better unleaded. That's a good mantra. And, you know, smoke-free. We are encouraging through our HUD's public housing that the housing authorities adopt smoke-free policies. So a little bit about our office. Our director is Matt Ammon. He's located up in headquarters in Washington, D.C. And we have four major divisions. We have our grants division. We have the regional management and technical support division, which I'm a part of. We have the lead enforcement, and we have our policies and standard division. Well, our office started in the early 1990s to address lead-based paint and housing that's built before when?
1978.
Oh, that's great, that's great. And really, the law states that lead-based paint was banned for manufacture of, for residential use, but just it was not banned for sale. So there's still, at that time, lead-based paint that was being sold, and so it's still an issue today. So as 10 years after our office was actually formed, we actually started saying, well, since we're going into the home, and it's hard to get into folks' home, are we gonna address multiple environmental issues in the home? So now we do a whole healthy homes assessment that address asthma triggers, as such as mold and mildew, and carbon monoxide detectors, smoke detectors, trips and falls, and other environmental issues that can be prevented. So our mission, let me go back. Our mission is to reduce health and safety hazards in housing in a comprehensive manner and cost-effective manner with a particular focus on protecting the health of children and other sensitive populations and low-income households. And typically, with regards to lead-based paint, we actually focus on children that are under the age of 6. That's when they're most vulnerable to lead-based paint poisoning. So some of the other initiatives that we have in our office, of course, is lead-based paint hazards. Asbestos. Asbestos, when it becomes friable, is actually harmful and causes lung disease. And so it's important that we don't, typically asbestos can be found in tiles that are 9x9, so that you don't disturb the asbestos tile. Allergies related to dust and roach, fracas, and vermin, those all cause asthma triggers within the home. We have radon. Radon also causes lung issues. And we have the indoor and outdoor pesticides that cause indoor air quality issues. And secondhand smoke is also an important indoor issue that impacts the health of occupants. So, oh, let me. Now, here's a present. Now, how, what's the percentage of time that individuals spend indoors?
90%.
I picked that up. Yes. And so which, sorry, I should have stopped myself. But yeah, I remember when we were discussing this earlier. When I was a child, on Saturdays, I would stay outside all day long. I couldn't get in my mother's house unless I had to go to the restroom. But it was something as simple as, you know, getting water. She says, oh, use the spigot. So now kids don't spend that amount of time outdoors as they used to spend outdoors. Safety is an issue. The reason why kids are not outdoors in an unstructured environment. And so we spend most of our time, again, 90% of our time indoors, either in church or in schools or in the homes. So it's important that we address those indoor issues. So carbon monoxide detectors. Earlier this month, on the Eastern Shore of Maryland, 8 family members actually died because of not having CO detectors. So it's important, and these are very inexpensive, and now they have the multiple, the combo of the smoke detectors and CO detectors. So it's important that we educate our clients, in particular parents, that they should invest in these detectors. And can anyone name, by raise of hand, what is the month that is Health and Safety Month? June.
July.
The episode went online. Yes, June. It's coming up. Yes. June. It's June. It's June. It's June. Love it. So, why is lead-based paint a concern? And Christy already went over this, but it's irreversible. It causes brain and nervous system damage. It reduces the intelligence and also promotes learning disabilities. And so in 2012, the CDC's advisory committee has created a new reference level in terms of lead exposure. So it went from 10 micrograms per deciliter as sort of like a level of action to 5 micrograms per deciliter. And with that, it increased the number of children that may be exposed to lead led to 500,000, over 500,000. So CDC has determined that there is no safe level of lead in the system. So how many of you are aware about the unrest that's going on in Baltimore? So young man, Freddie Gray, actually was lead poisoned. And see, and this is, I'm gonna give you a scenario. So what happens is that once a child is lead poisoned and they're not treated for lead poison, there's hyperactivity that is misdiagnosed as attention deficit disorder. And so that goes through that pattern of behavioral issues. They then get into labeled as a troubled child. They then get put out of class. They then get a sort of a distaste for school. And then in ninth grade or so, they drop out. And then they have no skill sets. So you don't have any skill sets or job skills, then you result to the behavior of, you know, criminal behavior. And so he actually won a case. So he got about $1 million or so. So, but this is in his teens. I mean, it happened 2 years ago. So the issue was not money, but the impact of the lead poisoning happened when he was a child. And so, you know, when you get, so he had the money, but still he already developed that behavior. And the and this is a contributing factor, so we don't know definitely, but as it states, and this happened in April, this is in the Washington Post, the walls and windowsills containing enough lead to poison the children and leave them incapable of leading functional lives. So you being on the front line of your interactions with the clients that we're trying to reach, you know, it's up to, you know, you can pass the information on to the parents in terms of if they live in a pre-1978 home, then they need to check for lead-based paint, peeling paint, and, you know, even educating your children. Because I know my son is 4 years old, as I said. He'll come on and tell me, you know, what I should be doing. So even educating the child that they can go home to the mom and say, hey, you know, that's peeling paint, we may have an issue. And if they're living in HUD housing, such as Section 8 or Housing Choice Voucher, HUD is responsible to ensuring that that house is lead safe. And so it's important that, you know, we address this at a younger age so that there are certain medical treatments such as chelation where they can sort of take the lead out the blood system. And it's very painful, but you know, this may have prevented Freddie from leading this life in which he ended up dying in police custody. So lead poison is real at this point. So Mississippi, has about, for the action level, Mississippi has only 89. However, for the new reference level, there's almost 3,500 children that meet that range of, you know, some sort of intervention needs to be done in that home to determine whether or not there is lead exposure in the home. And so right now, we have a grant program that I didn't mention where we provide grants to local and state governments to actually go in and we will inspect, identify lead hazards in the home. We provide grant monies to the homeowner to make those corrections, and we'll make the home safe. It'll have a clearance test, what we call, to ensure that that home is safe, as well as educate the family. Now, at this time, the state of Mississippi does not have a grant. And so I spoke with Crystal, and they're going to apply. The grant just was announced, the award, the funding was announced last week. We have over $100 million, and so hopefully the state of Mississippi will be successful in receiving this funding. They can get up to $3 million, depending on what grant they apply to, or $3.5 million. So that'd be a great resource for your clients, and if you own a residential daycare, you'll be eligible for the program, but not for commercial facilities. Only private homes are eligible for the program. But it is a resource. So Mississippi has its own lead-based paint laws. So, and which includes EPA's what we call Renovate, Write, and Protect law, and that's what Dennis operates that program. So if you have a facility or a home and you're going to do any type of work in terms of renovations, then your contractor must be RRP certified. And so Dennis is the one that you
go to. Real quick. Renovations, yes, but also keep in mind, if you've got maintenance people or handymen that are gonna come in and do work and they're gonna be scraping, sanding, paint in a pre-78 facility, they are also regulated and must be certified. You've got my contact information in the red trifold pamphlet in your handouts. Call me and I'll discuss what the law requires.
And Mississippi is very stringent, and the regulation states no person may engage in lead-based paint activities and target housing or child-occupied facilities as an inspector, risk assessor, project designer, supervisor, and what he means, renovator or worker, unless they are, in fact, certified. And what is the fee for that? I know EPA is $37,500. Are you
$37,500 is the penalty EPA can assess on a per violation basis. Mississippi understands that the typical Mississippi property owner, commercial business owner, cannot pay that. Our main concern is the health and safety of the people of Mississippi. We work primarily to make sure that if there is a lead paint exposure, we want it remediated. We want it cleaned up so that it's a safe environment. We don't worry about collecting a lot of money from you. We want the kids safe.
Yes.
That's our primary goal. So, and I have a big saying, and this is true for any of the agencies in the state. We would rather you call us and let us spend 20 minutes on the phone telling you what the law requires than 2 days writing up paperwork about a violation.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes.
So if you've got any situation that you have a question or concern about, please call us. We are nice people.
Now here's a question by raising hands. Who do you need to call when you need to lead question?
Dennis.
Marisa and I, she said, over in the back. I get you. And that's my last ride.
You're good.
But luckily, he doesn't have the 37. And here's the differences between these federal regulations for RRP and the state of Mississippi. Here, just a quick. And now, so I have the work. We're supposed to be fun. It's hard to be fun sometimes with lead. But if someone, I go to each, pick out a couple of tables. If you can find some of the hazards that lead hazards here, and this potential lead hazards. We've got playground. Sources in the home.
Paint's been open, which is not safe.
Okay, okay.
The wart holes.
All right, let me move around. That's good. So they mentioned the paint can being open, the water hose, areas with that may have lead exposure.
The water hose.
Oh, what about the playground? Playgrounds are often areas that perhaps have lead exposure. Look. With toys, yes, toys.
They mentioned the blinds.
Mini blinds. Mm-hmm. And that's a big issue HUD had with some of its public housing about the mini blinds. Like Crystal said, you know, once the sun hits it, what happens, it breaks down. Can you find any other areas that, look. It was once said that, oh, yeah.
Yep,
that is right. That is right. That is right. Some pipes have lead in it. Yes. Well, that's good. So these are some of the things that just keep in mind if you're a residential facility or even talking with your student. So, next. So, actually, Crystal mentioned the 7 Healthy Homes Principles. Now, since then, HUD, with other federal agencies, we actually updated the principles. Now there's the 8 principles. So, and I'll just move down, so she's already gone over the first 7. Keep it dry, keep it clean, keep it safe, keep it well ventilated, keep it pest-free, keep it contaminant-free, keep it well maintained. And some of these are just common sense. And so, and the 8th one now is keep it thermally controlled. You know, it's believed that, you know, any type of extreme heat or cold is going to cause undesirable temperatures within the home. So it's important that it's, you add insulation. It's going to promote one thing, energy efficiency as well as cost savings. And so we have materials on our website at www.hud.gov/lead. And you can always, you know, certainly download those for your use. But everyone should have received one of these. Now, if you pull it out, something is actually wrong with this house in terms of trips and falls. Can anybody name that? Yes. How can you have a healthy house with no railings? So I got my 5-minute cue, so I'm going to move over to the next. Smoke-free. This is a big push by HUD for our public housing. What we're trying to do is encourage public housing to adopt smoke-free policies within the unit. What we've learned is that smoke migrates between walls. There is no protected class in terms of it's my right not to smoke. We're encouraging it, but it's soon probably going to be a mandate. In Mississippi, over 500 non-smokers die every year from secondhand smoke. So it's real. Cigarette smoke also contains over 7,000 chemicals, and diseases that are caused by smoking include COPD. You have coronary heart disease, stroke, lung cancer, and oral cancer, throat cancer. So there's many negative aspects of smoking, besides the cost. You know, that's the main thing. So the biological marker for smoke is cotinine. And so this is, they found levels in children who are in various types of housing. The highest level is in apartment buildings, because what happens is, of course, the smoke will migrate through the walls as well as ventilation systems. So the only way that we can safely help the indoor occupants and children is to ban smoking on the inside of public housing. So you're more or less likely to have cotinine if it's in a house, but in an apartment, it's almost twice. So what have we been doing with HUD? We've issued notices to our housing authorities to adopt smoke-free policies to our multi-family properties. And we also have toolkits that we provided to help those housing authorities adopt smoke-free policy. As of to date, we have about 16% of our housing authorities that have, in fact, adopted smoke-free policies. That's about 300. Why is smoke-free housing policy? Why smoke-free housing policy? There is no risk-free level of exposure to secondhand smoke. We have cases where we have senior housing where the seniors may have oxygen in one hand, oxygen tank, and a cigarette in the other. So, but they're like, oh, I've been doing this for 80 years, you know, so that's hard. But, you know, so it's important that you provide accommodate an area within a property where, you know, folks can smoke. HUD is not requesting that, you know, folks just stop smoking altogether, but just don't smoke in the indoor, as well as, you know, we ask our housing authorities to work with local health departments so they can encourage cessation programs to stop smoking. And so once again, walls do not protect individuals from smoking secondhand smoke exposure, and you know, one study shows that air in 89% of non-smoking units contained nicotine. So that's I like this one. My apartment stinks because my neighbors smoke. So, and here's some, again, 16% of our housing authorities have smoke-free policies. And here's some resources for you to provide to your clients, your families, and I also have a one-pager that maybe you can make copies for your clients during June Safety Month that you can just send home to them so they're made aware of what they can do in their own home to make it more safe. And that's it. All right.